Everyone, welcome to the Inclusive Workforce Through Inclusive Partnership, Lessons from USAID Indonesia Mitra Kunci. My name is Luke Reba. I'll be the moderator for today's session. Today, we are fortunate to have participants, panelists, and attendees with different diverse languages and cultural backgrounds, and are all operating from different time zones and using various information technology platforms. So today we appreciate everyone's patience, grace, and understanding as we hope to highlight some incredible, impactful stories from the Mitra Kunci program. We will have 5 panelists, which will be presenting across numerous themes. All panelists can choose to turn their video on as they see fit or not. We ask that all attendees please stay muted. And if you have any questions at any time, please type those into the chat box and we will do our best to answer those after the presentations in the Q&A session, the question and answer session afterwards. I'd now like to turn this over to Bantu from Making Sense, who will provide us with an official introduction for today's session. Thanks, everybody.
Morning, good afternoon, and good evening to everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today. My name is Bantu Kumsa, and I am the program associate for the WIO 2030 initiative. Making Sense is excited to have DAI host today's WIO 2030 solution series webinar, which is focused on youth inclusion at work. Firstly, I would like to briefly provide some context for this and our other WIO 2030 solution series in our upcoming events. Brief background, as many of you may know, since 2007, Making Sense has been convening the Global Youth Economic Opportunity Summit to share learning, develop partnership, and advance economic opportunities for youth. And as we all have seen, the inequities that COVID and social justice movements have exposed have increased the need to accelerate change, particularly for young people, and has become a turning point for the Global Youth Economic Opportunity Summit agenda. And as a result, we are transforming our approach to fully include young people alongside adults in our activities. Which is to ensure that youth are co-designing solutions to their own problems and are not just serving as token representative on panel. In addition, we would like to expand the dialogue beyond just Washington, D.C. in the U.S. And we seek to host and support convenings around the world that will engage youth and adults locally to discuss solutions to the SDG8 that are relevant in their context. During 2021 and 2022, we are also doing this through a series of events you see listed on the slide, which includes youth dialogues, WIO solution sessions or webinars. These are on key topics of interest to young people. And we are also hosting regional and global convenings. All these are part of a series of near-term activities, which are designed to share the latest WIO program lesson, as well as gain commitment from our actors globally to advance good practices with common framework of the SDG. We are also working specifically for the achievement of the SDG8, which is to promote sustained, inclusive, and sustainable economic growth, full and productive employment, and decent work for all. We also plan to establish global convenings, our annual touchpoint, to track progress toward achievement of SDG8. Lastly, on our next slide, if we can move on to the next slide, I would like to briefly say thank you for our partners for their financial and in-kind contributions from our partners who have joined us on this exciting journey. In addition to DAI today, I specifically want to recognize Palladium, our global session partner, along with FHI 360 and DRS, who are regional session partners. We also want to acknowledge our first 2 local partners, Africa Skills Hub and the Latin America Leadership Academy. There are organizations joining us every day, so please let us know if you are interested in committing to WIO 2030. And without further ado, I would like to welcome Luke, who will be moderating today's session titled Inclusive Workforce Through Inclusive Partnership Lessons from Indonesia. And Luke, back to you.
Thank you so much, Bantu. Before we turn over to our first, first presentation and our second individual presenting, Lindsay Marita, I just wanted to make note that today we will have sign language interpreters by way of video on the side of your screens. And we will also, after each panelist presents slide by slide, we will be having in their language of choice, we will also be having a language interpretation following that. So just to allow everybody a little bit of time and patience at this as we move through this. And without further ado, I'd like to now turn over to Lindsay Marita, the chief of party for the Mitra Kunci project, who will be discussing some of the lessons learned in enabling environment strategy for the program. Over to you, Lindsay.
Yes, thank you, Luke. But before I start, I would like to make sure how the interpretation in Bahasa will be doing.
Yes,
yeah, Ibu, silakan.
Go ahead.
Yeah, so it will be consecutive, right?
Betul, Bu.
Yeah.
Jadi untuk
kawan-kawan yang berbahasa Indonesia, kawan-kawan, jadi nanti saya akan berbicara dalam menjelaskan dalam bahasa Inggris dan kemudian akan diterjemahkan oleh Mbak Hilda. Jadi ini untuk Mbak Sri dan kawan-kawan lain, Mbak Rahma sudah ada penerjemah dalam bahasa isyarat ya. So I will start my presentation. So Mbak Hilda will translate in Bahasa after I share the presentation. So I would like to introduce myself. My name is Lindsay Marita. I'm chief of party of USAID Mitra Kunci project. This is a 5-year project fully funded by USAID, and the goals or the aims for the project is to improve access to relevant skills, training, information, experience, and service for poor and vulnerable young people 18 to 34 years old, including women, persons with disability, and students in the province of West Java, Central Java, and East Java.
Baik, Bapak Ibu, jadi dari Ibu Lindsay, sebagai pembukaan, sebagai dari Chief of Party, ini proyek selama 5 tahun yang didanai oleh USAID. Tujuan utamanya adalah membuka akses untuk training, kemudian pengembangan skill untuk orang-orang muda, terutama yang kurang mampu dan dalam posisi rentan, termasuk perempuan, teman-teman dengan disabilitas, dan lokasinya di Provinsi Jawa Barat, Jawa Tengah, dan Jawa Timur.
Okay, next slide, please. Okay, this is a big picture of Indonesian condition now. So we have 203.970 million Indonesian of working age, 15 years and above, including the existing workforce, 15 to 64 years of 138.22 million people, based on the statistic on the August 2020. So Indonesia average labor force participation rate is at 67.77% with male participation is higher than female. And the 5 biggest livelihood sector in Indonesia are agriculture, following with the trade, manufacture, hospitality, and construction. And the need for new or better employment for the workforce in Indonesia became even more apparent during the COVID-19 pandemic that started in 2020. By August 2020, Indonesia opened unemployment rate had risen to 7.07%, 1.84% higher than the previous year rate.
Baik, Ibu, Bapak Ibu, secara singkat di sini ditunjukkan statistik untuk tenaga kerja. Poin pertama adalah jumlah tenaga kerja di usia muda, usia 15 sampai 64 tahun, jumlah ada 138 juta orang di usia tenaga kerja. Yang kedua, statistik tentang partisipasi rate di dunia tenaga kerja, di mana 67% masih dari laki-laki dan perempuan pada persentase 53,13%. Nah, area kerja yang paling banyak digeluti adalah bidang agriculture atau pertanian, trading, perdagangan, manufaktur, juga hospitality dan konstruksi. Kemudian di statistik yang terakhir ditunjukkan bahwa termasuk karena dampak pandemik yang dimulai tahun 2020 sudah terjadi peningkatan dari persentase orang-orang yang kehilangan pekerjaan sudah meningkat ke angka 7,07. Ini peningkatan sebesar 1,84% dari tahun sebelumnya.
Next slide, please. So this is approach that Mitra Kunci doing during our program. So we call this model Pentahelix. It include our partnership with the academic sector and the business and the community, government and media. So the goals or the aim for the partnership in practice is to strengthening vocational training center, inclusive workforce development at the provincial level, a student community service on entrepreneurship that we call KKN TKWU program with AIK University, private sector engagement on inclusive workforce development with GESI in human resource policy, and the initiation of the youth network for inclusive and decent work. We call the organization is a Jarum Kayu, advocating inclusive work and decent work in June 2021.
Jadi yang dilakukan melibatkan 5 pihak dari bidang akademia, kemudian sektor bisnis, komunitas, pemerintah, dan media. Dan kelima sektor ini berkolaborasi untuk secara umum 5 poin di sebelah kanan kita. Pertama, untuk memperkuat training-training vokasi. Kedua, untuk menciptakan dunia tenaga kerja yang lebih inklusif di level provinsi. Kemudian yang ketiga adalah untuk program-program KKN TKWU ini di universitas-universitas, dan yang keempat juga kita melibatkan sektor swasta dan untuk pengembangan GESI di kebijakan-kebijakan HRD. Kemudian yang kelima adalah inisiasi program bernama Jarum Kayu, ini mengadvokasi kerja dan lingkungan kerja yang baik yang untuk network atau jaringan orang-orang muda.
Okay, next slide, please. So this is that we're trying to do through our program to evolving for greater impact. So this project is ready going to scale up across Indonesia. So we already have a program with Minister of Education, Research and Technology in Indonesia, and we also already have some modules that ready place in the online platform, so it will be ready to use by a broader user. And also we develop guideline working with the private sector with APindo, one of the prominent employer association in Indonesia. So we develop the guideline for equity and inclusion in the workplace. So this is also already placed in the APindo website officially. And the other one, we also develop the guideline for the community training center. It's a BLK Komunitas in Indonesia to help them to be more inclusive in the future. Silakan, Mbak Hilda.
Jadi tentunya harapannya adalah dampaknya semakin besar, keinginan cita-cita untuk scale up atau memperluas apa yang hal-hal baik yang sedang dikerjakan. Nah, termasuk sudah melibatkan atau kerjasama dengan Kementerian Pendidikan terkait modul, kemudian online platform, ada juga kerjasama dengan Asosiasi Apindo sektor private atau sektor korporasi juga terkait guideline-guideline pedoman-pedoman yang memastikan dunia kerja yang lebih inklusif, kemudian juga disebutkan BLK untuk komunitas dengan tujuan yang sama ingin menciptakan dunia kerja yang lebih inklusif.
Next slide, please. So this is the result that have been recorded through our program, basically from the main indicator that we set with USAID in the beginning. So we achieved almost like 95%, and from 95%, I think mostly of them is higher, achieve higher target than we set previously. As you can see, this is a number here. the target that we have been set, this is a big number actually. And then, as you can see, we provide intervention through training or other intervention. So we reach a poor and vulnerable youth now have new skill. The number is a 40,371. And then from that number, the poor and vulnerable youth have a new job or better job. The number is a 15,817 person. Pak Ilda mungkin diterjemahin dulu angkanya banyak banget.
Ibu siap. Jadi Ibu Lensi menyampaikan bahwa indikator yang diset bersama dengan USAID ini sudah hampir rampung semua, sudah mencapai 95%, sudah mencapai 95%, dan targetnya tentunya ini ada target yang besar. Di sini ditampilkan pencapaiannya. Yang di kolom yang pertama 40.371 ini di mana teman-teman yang kurang mampu dan rentan mendapatkan skill baru. Kemudian Ibu menyampaikan kolom yang kedua 15.817 di mana teman-teman yang rentan dan kurang mampu mendapatkan pekerjaan yang lebih baik atau mendapatkan pekerjaan yang pertama untuk pertama kalinya juga. Saya lanjutkan ke yang berikutnya Bu atau
aku jelasin dulu kali ya
siap,
dalam bahasa Inggrisnya. Oke. Okay.
Ya.
So we also reach a youth with disability that currently have a new skill. We record or document 705 people with disabilities that have a new skill through our program. And then a youth with disability now have a new or better job. By the end of the project, we record is 246 people with disability have a new or better job. Silakan, Mbak Ida.
Sebanyak 704 teman-teman muda dengan disabilitas sekarang punya skill baru. 246 teman-teman muda dengan disabilitas sekarang punya pekerjaan baru dan pekerjaan atau pekerjaan yang lebih baik.
Yes, and through our program with university, this is a part of our program to support community field services that called KKN TKWU with focus to entrepreneurship program. So we also recorded that 908 students completed the entrepreneurial training and experience in local communities.
Angka berikutnya adalah 908. Ini jumlah yang terlibat dalam KKN kewirausahaan. Dan sebanyak jumlah ini adalah siswa universitas yang menyelesaikan training dan terlibat langsung di local community.
Yeah. This is the number the next Picture in the diagram is numbers of university and polytechnic that offering entrepreneurial training and experience to their student. So we record 14 university and polytechnic that have been provide training, entrepreneurial training and experience to their student, and 28 technical training institute, including TPET center or training center that more inclusive now following our intervention during Mitra Kunci program.
Dari intervensi program tim Mitra Kunci, ada 14 universitas dan politeknik yang menawarkan, yang ikut menawarkan training terkait kewirausahaan, dan sebanyak 28 juga training center yang training institute yang juga menawarkan, yang membuka program dengan lebih inklusif.
Next slide, please. And this is the legacy that we have been developed through our program. So as I mentioned previously, we developed the guidance for equality and inclusivity at the workplace. And then we also develop a guidance for a business process for the community BLK, and also roadmap for workforce, inclusive workforce for people with disability, and guidance for TPET center to be more inclusive.
Ya, Bapak Ibu, jadi mungkin ini tidak akan saya ulang satu-satu, tapi ini adalah hasil-hasil contoh dari berbagai macam guideline atau booklet, kemudian website, semua terkait kesetaraan, inklusivitas, kemudian bagaimana bisnis prosesnya yang lebih inklusif, juga ada roadmap di sini.
Okay, we also support one platform in Central Java. It's called eMakario. This is like job matching platform.
Termasuk sesuai namanya job matching platform, salah satunya yang disebut Makario yang sebelah kanan atas Ibu.
Okay, next slide please. And this is the four guidance, the module and three reference book that we support for our program with university and Minister of Education, Research and Technology, the module of the community service on entrepreneurship issue have been placed in official LMS under Minister of Education.
Berikutnya ini adalah modul-modul buku reference book yang juga dibuat dengan kolaborasi dengan Kementerian Ristek, Universitas. Di sini menyediakan berbagai informasi tentang kewirausahaan dan juga kuliah kerja nyata.
Okay, next slide please. Thank you. I think that's all from Mitra Kunci. Give it the time to Luke. Thank you, Luke.
Very much, Lindsay. And now we'd like to turn over to a presentation by Yofianis Sekera, who's the PWD Project Provincial Coordinator, who will be providing an overview of the implementation strategy for the employment and economic empowerment of persons with disabilities in East Java province. Over to you, Yofianis. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, thank you for this opportunity. Good morning, good evening to our participants. I'm Yofianis Tori Sakera, Project Coordinator of Employment and Economic Empowerment of Persons with Disabilities in East Java Province, Indonesia. So happy to be this wonderful forum. I will briefly talk about the lesson learned from our program, or I will shorten as EEPWD.
Bapak Ibu, Bapak Yofianus adalah project coordinator. Kita singkat projectnya dengan nama EEP WED ini untuk employment, economic empowerment untuk teman-teman dengan disabilitas untuk Provinsi Jawa Timur. Dilanjutkan Pak, silakan.
Okay. As a part of USAID Mitra Kunci program, it was launched in the end of 2020 for 1 year, which work in 7 cities in East Java province. Province to be the second largest population in Indonesia. We target young PWDs to be able to take advantage of employment and entrepreneur opportunities.
Bapak Ibu, Bapak Yovianus akan menyampaikan tentang lesson learned dari program. Jadi program ini dimulai tahun 2017 dan akan berakhir tahun Januari 2022, disupport oleh USAID dengan dikerjakan oleh tim-tim mitra kunci dan dilakukan di 7 kota di Jawa Timur dengan target teman-teman dengan disabilitas yang mengalami kerentanan dan agar dapat mendapatkan pekerjaan dan juga peluang-peluang untuk melakukan wirausaha.
In the context of inclusive partnership, we use an approach that we call market-based inclusive workforce development, where our project develops an end-to-end pipeline from community as a site in the left side, as you can see in the slide. On the side, we reach out to young person with disabilities.
Bapak Ibu, program ini betul-betul dilakukan dari ujung ke ujung atau end to end, di mana di sisi yang paling kiri dulu yang dijangkau adalah teman-teman muda ya dengan disabilitas.
Yes, in the middle, we use a training institution to build their competency, hard skill and soft skill that needed by the market. While on the right side, we encourage companies to open employment opportunities by recruiting PWDs as employees.
Kalau tadi sudah disebutkan yang di sisi paling kirinya, kemudian di tengahnya disiapkan persiapan tentang training, institusi training, sekolah, untuk membangun kompetensi, juga keahlian. Dan kemudian di ujung yang kanannya adalah juga melibatkan perusahaan-perusahaan atau pemberi kerja agar teman-teman mendapatkan peluang bekerja yang lebih baik.
Yes, of course the biggest challenge to adopting this approach is indeed that our project was run at the peak of COVID-19 pandemic.
Sebenarnya sebagaimana yang kita tahu, akhirnya tantangan yang salah satu tantangan yang besar adalah karena kita menghadapi pandemi COVID.
Okay, the next slide. Yes, through this approach, a project brought together or facilitated various parties to meet and collaborate to realize an inclusive workforce.
Proyek ini berusaha mengumpulkan berbagai pihak untuk bertemu dan kemudian berdiskusi dan berkolaborasi untuk dunia tenaga kerja yang lebih inklusif.
At the community level, we ensure that we can connect with PWDs through the organization or through their families. We consulted with and involved 77 disabled person organization to encourage their members to take part in this opportunity.
Dalam program ini di level komunitas, tim berusaha menjangkau teman-teman dengan disabilitas melalui organisasi, melalui keluarganya, dan saat ini sudah berhasil menjangkau 77 organisasi dan meminta organisasi untuk menyemangati anggotanya untuk ikut bergabung dalam peluang ini.
Yes, to improve skills, we work closely with technical and vocational education training or TVETs. Both managed by government and private entities to provide opportunities for PWDs. We also encourage government institutions to produce a regulation or program or and budgeting that supporting inclusive workforce.
Kemudian untuk memperbaiki skill bekerja tim bekerja sama dengan lembaga-lembaga training, teknik dan vokasi, kemudian juga mendorong berbagai institusi pemerintah untuk membangun regulasi, program dan juga penganggaran yang membantu dunia kerja yang lebih inklusif.
Yes. At the same time, we campaign to companies and financial institutions to provide equal opportunities to PWDs. This effort, of course, is something that needs to be improved in the future, but this project can bring this issue up to the companies.
Kemudian juga di saat yang sama, berusaha menjangkau banyak perusahaan-perusahaan, sektor private, institusi finansial, untuk juga membuka peluang bekerja untuk teman-teman dengan disabilitas, sehingga kita bisa mendapatkan masa depan yang lebih baik melalui program ini.
Yes. As a result, while we managed to reach 760 PWDs, of which 429 could be facilitated to receive various training. As you can see, this is the picture of the training events. After the training, 75 person can start their business with funding support, in-kind support, or partnership support with a company.
Ini adalah bagian dari tadi angka yang Ibu Lensis juga sudah sampaikan bersama bahwa untuk yang Bapak bidangnya adalah sebanyak 760 teman-teman disabilitas sudah berhasil dijangkau, di mana 429 sudah mendapatkan berbagai training, kemudian 75 sudah memulai memulai bisnis usaha mereka. Ini juga terkait support pendanaan, kemudian berbagai macam kolaborasi dengan pihak perusahaan.
Yes. For recruitment, there are only 13 person who can land their first job. It's a small number, but we are sure this opportunity is more open after the pandemic.
Kemudian angka yang berikutnya adalah sebanyak 13 teman-teman dari disabilitas yang sudah mendapatkan pekerjaan pertama mereka. Mungkin angka ini masih tampak kecil, tetapi kami yakin bahwa setelah berpandemik mereda atau berakhir, angka ini akan bisa semakin besar.
Okay, the next slide, please. This is some example of how PWD started their own business. As you can see, there is a welding workshop which is managed entirely by a person with disability. There are also a partnership with retail companies that lend their kiosk. While in another city, in Malang, they are running urban farming business from cultivation to food processing of catfish.
Ini ada berbagai contoh dari hal-hal luar biasa yang sudah dicapai oleh teman-teman dari disabilitas. Contohnya adalah mereka sudah bisa membangun semacam tempat untuk las, kemudian juga sebagai usaha mereka. Kemudian juga ini sepenuhnya dimanage oleh mereka sendiri, kemudian juga berpartner dengan perusahaan-perusahaan retail yang membangun kios. Kemudian juga di Kota Malang ada berbagai macam usaha-usaha terkait urban farming, untuk pangan, juga untuk seperti ikan lele.
Okay, the next slide. Finally, the market-based inclusive workforce development approach that we apply in this project creates an enabling environment where the government, companies, TVETs, and of course, persons with disability celebrate an inclusive partnership.
Bapak Ibu, pada akhirnya yang diinginkan adalah dengan pendekatan market-based inclusive workforce ini, kita ingin mencapai sebuah environment atau lingkungan yang memungkinkan pemerintah, perusahaan, lembaga-lembaga training atau pelatihan, juga tentunya teman-teman dengan disabilitas bisa merayakan pencapaian yang berupa kolaborasi yang lebih inklusif.
Okay, the last slide. Thank you very much for your attention. That's all my presentation.
Very much, Ophianis. We'll now move into our panelist discussion. First speaker, Sri Setyanishi, the chairperson of the Boyolali Communication Forum for Persons with Disabilities. Sri will be discussing the role of organizations of persons with disabilities in supporting the economic and employment empowerment of persons with disabilities. Over to you, Sri. Thank you.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Terima kasih. Perkenalkan, saya Sri Setyaningsih. Di sini saya akan berbagi pengalaman apa yang sudah dilaksanakan oleh Forum Komunikasi Difabel Boyolali terkait pemberdayaan disabilitas melalui pelibatan multi pihak. Lanjut. Dan ini yang menjadi latar belakang program dan kegiatan kami, di mana Forum Komunikasi Difabel Boyolali merupakan organisasi difabel di Kabupaten Boyolali yang berkegiatan di 22 kecamatan, merupakan dampingan dari Dinas Sosial, dan mempunyai anggota disabilitas kurang lebih 6.000 disabilitas.
So, Ibu Sri, Ibu Sri is presenting the title of empowerment.
Tadi mendapatkan program ini. Maaf.
Ya, yeah, baik. Ibu Sri is presenting the title empowerment of people with disability in involving various party. And the area is in the district of Boyolali. Ibu mentioned that this is involving 22 sub-district. Lanjut, Ibu.
Dan FKDB Karya Mandiri mendapatkan program hibah dari Mitra Kunci USAID pada tahun 2018 dengan pendampingan dari BP3D dan Dinkop Naker. Dan dari program tersebut memberikan pembelajaran mengenai pentingnya pelibatan dukungan multi pihak dalam upaya pemberdayaan disabilitas. Lanjut.
This activity is supported by Mitra Kunci USAID starting from 2018. This is from a grant program and also assisted by the government agency, and the learning from this the learning lesson, the essential learning lesson is to involve various multi-party in improving the empowerment for people with disability.
Dan inilah ini foto waktu FKDB menjadi apa ya? Perwakilan penandatangan MOU dengan BLKI dan dihadiri oleh Gubernur Jawa Tengah. Dan inilah alur program pemberdayaan wirausaha difabel di Kabupaten Boyolali. Yang pertama, asesmen calon penerima manfaat, di mana kami perlu mengetahui kondisi, terus potensi dan kemampuan teman-teman disabilitas. Dan kami terus dari asesmen kami melaksanakan pelatihan soft skill, dan dari soft skill kami melaksanakan pelatihan hard skill yang sesuai dengan hasil asesmen. Jadi pelatihan keterampilan yang kita berikan itu sesuai dengan minat dan bakat dari anak tersebut, dan dilanjutkan dengan pelatihan managerial skill, terus lanjut lagi ke pemagangan. Jadi teman-teman ini kita siapkan benar-benar siap bersaing di dunia industri maupun di wirausaha.
The picture that you're looking at is an MOU signing between the team and also there's a governor present. And the Ibu is explaining the sequence. First, you had to do the assessment for the beneficiary to make sure that they have the correct, the matching potential skill, continue by soft skill, hard skill, managerial skill, and to make sure that they are also internship, to make sure that they are truly competitive in the market. Next.
Lanjut. Dan inilah kerja sama multi pihak yang kami lakukan dengan bentuk koordinasi dengan pemerintah, dilakukan melalui audiensi untuk memaparkan rencana, hasil, dan tindak lanjut program yang telah kami lakukan. Setelah audiensi komunikasi perlu tetap dibangun melalui berbagai platform. Contohnya seperti diskusi terbatas, komunikasi via telepon, dan pesan. Terus kami juga melibatkan sektor industri untuk penempatan kerja, seperti PT Alfamart dan PT Pan Brother TBK, di mana di tahun 2018 kami mendapatkan program mitra kunci, dan dari situlah kami tetap membangun komunikasi dengan pihak-pihak tersebut. Terus kami juga meningkatkan jaringan menjadi anggota Youth Support Network dan komunitas difabel antar kota untuk saling sharing dan saling komunikasi, berbagi ilmu. Dan hasil dari kegiatan yang sudah kami lakukan, kami paparkan dalam Musrenbangkap dan mendapatkan sambutan baik dari Bupati Boyolali yang ditindaklanjuti dengan menjadi prioritas penggunaan kios milik Pemkab Boyolali di Kebun Raya Indropilo.
So, Ibu is emphasizing of the importance of having multi-party being involved. The team always started with a presentation, implementation, and even after the implementation, the communication needs to be sustained. There needs to be a continuous discussion along with the industry, making sure that they're also open for work placement. And also, the team expand the network, sharing knowledge, and this all of this effort is already appreciated by the government.
Next.
Sri.
Ya. Di sini enggak ini. Dan ini dan di sini ada foto di mana foto kami sedang melakukan audiensi dengan Bupati Boyolali. Dan di situ juga ada foto ketika kami melakukan kegiatan pelatihan soft skill. Jadi di mana trainer itu belum memahami disabilitas, maka kami ikut turun untuk bersatu membantu trainer untuk komunikasi dengan disabilitas. Dan di situ juga terlihat foto kami habis melakukan atau ikut kegiatan Musrenbang Kabupaten, serta di mana itu ada foto kios yang berjajar. Di situ kami sedang melakukan analisis akses untuk kios yang sudah diberikan kepada kami dan
yeah. So Ibu is explaining the picture that you're looking at are various pictures. There are the meeting with the head district training, soft skill, including the need of the team to train the trainer in regarding how to help the student who has disability, and also this having discussion, continuous discussion, and also those are the you're looking at kiosks and having analysis for that as well.
Sri, monggo lanjut, Mbak. Mbak Sri, suaranya nggak kedengeran. Oke. Okay. Mbak Sri bisa dengar kita, Mbak Sri? Mungkin Mbak Hilda bisa langsung bantu diterjemahkan ke bahasa Inggris saja, Mbak. Kelihatannya Mbak Sri ada problem dengan koneksi.
We are having a signal problem, so I'm just going to continue to the last slide, the lesson learned. Ibu Sri wrote that the lesson learned is one, the need of collaboration, multi-party. This is a strategic measure in order to improve the opportunity for our friends with disability. And number two, there's important to have a persuasive communication strategy as well, with good intention to have all stakeholders collaborate, so that that's become a key of success in order to have the needed support. And the third conclusion is intensive communication is needed, not just to make sure that the program will be continuous or sustainable, but also to make sure that there are development with the perspective of the people, including people with disability, as the stakeholder. That concludes the presentation.
Sri and everyone. We'll now turn to our second panelist and speaker, Dr. Kokok Adi Prayogo, who's the head of sociocultural division in the Bapeda Pasuruan district. Dr. Kokok will be discussing the strategy and implementation of sustainable inclusive development in the district. Over to you, Dr. Kokok. Thank you.
Oke, okay, terima kasih. Next slide, please. Oke. Okay. Baik, terima kasih atas waktu yang telah diberikan. Malam ini atau di Amerika, pada pagi hari ini, saya akan mempresentasikan terkait strategi dan implementasi pembangunan inklusi berkelanjutan di Kabupaten Pasuruan. Khususnya, kami akan mereview terkait penyandang disabilitas melalui inisiatif yang kita beri nama Dikdaya dengan Sibola atau pemberdayaan disabilitas dengan sinergi dan kolaborasi.
Pak Koko will start the presentation. First, greeting to everybody in different time zone. So the title of this presentation is as shown in English, the strategy and implementation of sustainable inclusive development in Pasuruan district. A review of empowered person with disability through synergy and collaboration.
Sebelum saya melanjutkan presentasi saya ingin mengucapkan selamat Hari Disabilitas Internasional yang pada tahun ini mengambil tema kepemimpinan dan partisipasi penyandang disabilitas menuju dunia pasca COVID-19 yang inklusif, mudah diakses dan berkelanjutan.
Also, we are commemorating a very important day. The theme of this year's celebration is leadership of people with disability, especially post-COVID.
Next slide, please. Okay, kita tahu bersama bahwa SDGs target ke-8 menyatakan bahwa mendukung pertumbuhan ekonomi yang inklusif dan berkelanjutan, tenaga kerja yang penuh dengan produktif, serta pekerjaan yang layak bagi semua. Kalimat ini menyatakan bahwa harus ada ketercapaian ketenagakerjaan secara penuh dan produktif dan pekerjaan yang layak bagi seluruh perempuan, laki-laki, termasuk kaum muda dan orang dengan disabilitas.
BAPA is emphasizing on the SDG where to promote sustained, inclusive, sustainable economic growth, full productive employment and decent work for all meaning for men, women, young people, people with disability.
Sebagai bahan informasi awal bahwa di Kabupaten Pasuruan, penyandang disabilitas masih cukup tinggi. Berdasarkan data kami dari Dinas Sosial, terdapat 1.267 penyandang disabilitas dengan kategori fisik sebanyak 60%, kategori mental 20%, kemudian kategori sensorik 16%, sedangkan sisanya adalah disabilitas ganda dan intelektual. Dari seluruh jumlah tersebut, sebagian besar dikelompokkan sebagai hanya bisa menerima bantuan dan masih kurang dari 5% yang bisa memasuki dunia kerja maupun dunia usaha atau secara mandiri melakukan entrepreneur.
This slide shows that in our district, there's still a lot of our friends that with disability. There are 1,267, and among them are divided into various type of condition. There are physical disability, mental disability, sensory disability, multiple and intellectual disability. And we want to make sure that right now the condition are they're not fully assisted and not included in the not fully included in the workforce. Also in terms of entrepreneurship, it's still difficult for them to reach that.
Merujuk permasalahan tersebut, kami di Babeda, Badan Perencanaan Pembangunan Daerah Kabupaten Pasuruan, karena Kabupaten Pasuruan mempunyai segenap potensi yang ada dengan model pentaholic, kami bersama-sama melakukan sinergi kolaborasi untuk menyelesaikan permasalahan tersebut dengan berbagai macam pelibatan baik dari industri, kemudian masyarakat, organisasi masyarakat, kemudian akademisi, kemudian public authorities, kemudian yang terakhir adalah NGO, dalam hal ini Mitra Kunci dan NGO-NGO yang lainnya, melakukan inisiatif untuk mengatasi permasalahan tersebut secara konkret dengan pemberdayaan disabilitas melalui sinergi dan kolaborasi.
The important keyword here is synergy and collaborative to best give the best support. This is among NGO, the government, the community, including to identify the capacity, identify of the business needs, providing skill and training, assisting until they got accepted into the workforce. And making sure that they also have the opportunity to build their entrepreneurship skill.
Okay. Ada tiga tujuan inisiatif yang kami lakukan. Yang pertama adalah memfasilitasi peningkatan kapasitas dan kompetensi saudara-saudara disabilitas melalui bimbingan teknis dan pelatihan. Kemudian tujuan yang kedua, memfasilitasi akses disabilitas terhadap dunia kerja dan dunia wirausaha. Kemudian tujuan yang ketiga adalah memfasilitasi terbentuknya regulasi berupa peraturan daerah maupun peraturan kepala daerah dalam rangka optimalisasi pemberdayaan disabilitas.
So there are three main things here. First, to make sure that there are training capability to facilitate the improvement of the capability, and also number two, give access to work, and number three, also to support in terms of regulation.
Next slide, please. Okay. Ada tahapan-tahapan yang kita laksanakan dari inisiatif Dikdaya dengan Sibola. Yang pertama adalah identifikasi kapasitas dan keterampilan disabilitas. Pada tahapan yang pertama ini, kami bersama dengan dinas terkait, bersama dengan NGO, melakukan identifikasi kapasitas dan kompetensi yang dimiliki oleh segenap disabilitas, sehingga akan tahu permasalahan dan yang dibutuhkan serta diharapkan oleh teman-teman disabilitas.
The first step would be to identify capability. It's important for us to identify the hope and the wishes of the people with disability.
Kemudian tahapan yang kedua adalah kebutuhan, kita mengidentifikasi kebutuhan dari dunia usaha. Pada tahapan ini kita bersama-sama melakukan FGD, mengumpulkan beberapa perusahaan terkait yang ada di Kabupaten Pasuruan untuk melakukan identifikasi kebutuhan-kebutuhan baik berupa soft skill, baik berupa hard skill yang dibutuhkan oleh teman-teman perusahaan, sehingga nantinya ketika teman-teman disabilitas yang sudah memiliki kapasitas dan kompetensi mampu diterima di perusahaan terkait.
The next step is to make sure that between the supply and the demand match, so involving various companies, having FGDs to identify what are the needs of the corporation or the job giver related to the soft skill and the hard skill to make sure that it matches.
Tahapan yang ketiga adalah pemberian pelatihan keterampilan bagi teman-teman disabilitas yang disesuaikan dengan kebutuhan dunia usaha, baik pemberian keterampilan tersebut berupa hard skill maupun soft skill.
The next step is providing the skill itself, both soft skill and hard skill.
Tahapan yang keempat adalah melakukan pendampingan bagi teman-teman disabilitas sampai mereka betul-betul diterima di dalam dunia pekerjaan. Pendampingan ini dilakukan oleh beberapa NGO yang ada di Kabupaten Pasuruan yang terkait dengan pemberdayaan teman-teman disabilitas.
The next step is also providing assistance up to they are accepted to work. This is assisted by various NGO.
Tahapan yang kelima adalah memberikan alternatif solusi bagi penyandang disabilitas yang belum diterima di dunia pekerjaan. Mereka akan kita arahkan untuk berwirausaha melalui pemberian keterampilan, melalui pemberian pelatihan yang diberikan oleh beberapa NGO seperti Kupu Sutra ataupun NGO-NGO yang lain, sehingga mereka juga tidak tergantung pada hanya dunia pekerjaan.
And also to make sure that they have their independency, meaning that to give them also alternative solution. Those who cannot get a job at a corporation or as an employee, they have other opportunities as an entrepreneur, and they need the skill, and the skill are provided by training by various NGO as well.
Next slide, please. Dampak dari inisiatif yang sudah kami lakukan, yang pertama adalah ada sebanyak 60 penyandang disabilitas yang mendapat pelatihan wirausaha budidaya ulat sutra dari lembaga Kupu-Kupu Sutra yang ada di Kabupaten Pasuruan, yang merupakan salah satu NGO yang intens dan terhadap teman-teman disabilitas. Kemudian ada 16 penyandang disabilitas yang mendapat bimbingan teknis dan pelatihan 18 hari dari BLK atau Badan Layanan Pekerjaan, baik dari provinsi maupun dari kabupaten. Kemudian yang ketiga adalah ada 32 penyandang disabilitas yang sudah diberikan pelatihan mulai dari pembuatan roti, kue, menjahit dari UPT BLK Rejoso Kabupaten Pasuruan, dan ada 2 penyandang disabilitas yang mendapat pelatihan dari Panti Rehabilitasi Sosial di Bangil. Kemudian yang terakhir adalah ada penyandang sejumlah 6 penyandang disabilitas yang sudah mendapat pelatihan dari BLK Kabupaten Pasuruan.
Ladies and gentlemen, this slide has explained it very well. So I'm going to brush up very quickly. 60% as Bapak is explaining the number of people who has been assisted in various types of training, in various types of field, including technical guidance and various types of training.
Kemudian dampak yang kedua adalah terdapat 3 penyandang disabilitas yang sudah diterima bekerja di PT FNG. Kemudian ada 2 penyandang disabilitas yang sudah diterima di PT Alfamidi. Kemudian ada 18 penyandang disabilitas yang sedang dalam proses pendampingan dari Dinas Koperasi dan UM untuk mendapatkan bantuan modal usaha sebesar Rp7.500.000 per orang.
And the essence of the slide, the part two is the number of people who has worked in various, this is a very established companies, and also those that has accepted capital assistance as an SME.
Kemudian dampak yang terakhir dari inisiatif yang sudah kami lakukan adalah sudah terbitnya peraturan daerah nomor 6 tahun 2021 tentang penyandang disabilitas sebagai payung kebijakan untuk percepatan pemberdayaan disabilitas di Kabupaten Pasuruan. Melalui peraturan daerah ini, besar harapan akses terhadap penyandang disabilitas untuk pekerjaan, untuk dunia usaha itu dapat terbuka dengan lebar. Kemudian yang berikutnya adalah peran aktif dari segenap stakeholder, mulai dari dunia usaha, kemudian industri, kemudian stakeholder yang lainnya, organisasi masyarakat, mampu diberi kesempatan untuk secara aktif melakukan pemberdayaan, membuka akses kepada teman-teman disabilitas.
And the good news is that there are this regulation, as you seen on the slide, that has been ratified. This is the umbrella for to accelerate the empowerment. This will open a wider working opportunity and also as a platform for active participation of various stakeholders.
Oke, okay, yang terakhir, slide terakhir, next slide, please. Sebagai penyemangat bagi kita semua, perlu kami sampaikan di sini bahwa layanan terhadap disabilitas merupakan ukuran kemajuan sebuah daerah, khususnya bagi Kabupaten Pasuruan. Sehingga penting bagi kita untuk menyadari bahwa disabilitas adalah saudara kita. Salah satu bentuk komitmen kepedulian kita pada saudara kita adalah memberikan kemudahan akses berwirausaha dan ketenagakerjaan bagi mereka. Kalau bukan kita, siapa lagi? Kalau bukan sekarang, kapan lagi? Salam inklusi. Sekian dan terima kasih.
Ladies and gentlemen, so to uplift the spirit, it's the service that is provided, let's say, by an area shows how developed that area. If the service for the people with disability is good, meaning that the development of that area is good. And Bapak has wrote here the commitment and to provide easy access to entrepreneur and employment. We are the one who should be doing that to take the first step.
Oke, sekian dari saya. Semoga bermanfaat. Saya akhiri, selamat malam dan selamat pagi. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
May peace be upon us all. That's the end of the presentation.
Very much, Dr. Kokok. And now over to our third panelist, Sulaiman Mahdi, who's the Sustainability Manager for the H&M Group Production Office in Indonesia. Sulaiman will discuss the efforts to promote equality and inclusivity in the workplace at H&M. To you, Sulaiman.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity. Selamat malam, teman-teman. Selamat pagi, teman-teman di Amerika. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Ladies and gentlemen, greetings. Assalamualaikum. May peace be upon us all from everybody in different time zone.
Ya. Terima kasih atas kesempatannya. Dalam kesempatan ini saya akan menjelaskan sedikit cerita tentang lesson learned yang kita dapatkan dalam salah satu proyek kita, WIN Projects, A Collaborative Approach for a More Inclusive Workplace.
Papa will explain, this is a story, a lesson learned of WIN Project, a collaborative approach for a more inclusive workplace.
Yeah. Next slide, please. H&M adalah salah satu global companies yang punya sekitar hampir 5.000 stores di seluruh dunia. Tetapi ketika bicara spesifik Indonesia, store kita ada 52 stores di 20 kota di Indonesia dan mulai beroperasi di tahun 2013.
H&M is a global company with 5,000 stores all over the world. In Indonesia, however, there's 52 stores currently operating in 20 cities.
Ya, tetapi ketika kita bicara H&M Productions di Indonesia, itu sudah ada sejak sekitar tahun awal 2000-an, itu sudah ada. Nah, di sini kita tidak punya pabrik, tapi kita bekerja sama dengan bisnis partner kita yang adalah pabrik garments dan textile yang ada sekitar 70 bisnis partner dan mensupport sekitar 160 ribu karyawan yang diantaranya adalah 80%-nya perempuan.
H&M is collaborating with local garment company to do their production. There are 70 business partner supporting 100,061,994 workers and 80% among them are women.
Ya, jadi dibayangkan kalau misalnya kita bicara pabrik itu angka karyawannya sekitar 2.000 sampai 10.000.
In terms of factory, there's quite a large number of employee, about 2.000 ya Pak ya?
Ya, 2.000 sampai 10.000 per pabrik, setiap pabrik.
10,000 per factory.
Ya. Next slide, please. So dalam beberapa approach kita di sustainability, salah satunya adalah kita ada program yang bernama Workplace Inclusions atau kita bilang WIN gitu.
The WIN stands for Workplace Inclusion.
Lalu kemudian itu adalah salah satu pendekatan sustainability kita dan kita ingin menempatkan human rights di sebagai fundamental aspek dalam bisnis kita dan kita ingin memperlakukan semua individu dalam respect, dalam martabat mereka sesuai dengan humanity, human rights yang menjadi fundamental aspek dalam bisnis kita.
The fundamental platform of the business is sustainability, upholding human rights, respect and dignity of individuals.
Yeah. WIN program ini juga seperti tadi yang dijelaskan presenter sebelumnya, Dr. Koko, kalau kita juga sama ingin mendorong bekerja kolaborasi untuk bisa mendorong mencapai SDG nomor 8, promoting full productive employment untuk semua.
As presented by Pak Koko, the previous presentation, this is in line that we also want to support the SDG number 8.
Jadi inti dari program WINS ini adalah bagaimana kita memberikan equal opportunity, akses yang lebih baik kepada employment, kepada teman-teman person with disability.
Including equal opportunity for employment for people with disability.
Yeah. Dan yang ingin kita capai adalah dalam jangka pendek, kita ingin supplier-supplier factory kita itu punya recruitment policies, reasonable accommodations, dan compliance dalam numbers of workers with disability di dalam operations factory mereka sebagai target jangka pendek dari program ini.
The short-term aim, along the supply chain, we want to make sure the recruitment policy has include making sure that the compliance in terms of the number of people with disability who can work in the supply chain.
Ya, dan sebagai jangka panjang tentu kita ingin membangun budaya workplace inclusions di dalam supplier-supplier factory kami dan harapannya at the end itu akan pada akhirnya itu akan mendorong teman-teman pekerja dengan disabilitas bekerja lebih nyaman dan bisa bekerja lebih lama di perusahaan supplier kami.
The long term aim is the creating the inclusive culture. We want people with disability have comfort in working in the company and also will sustain long in the job.
Yeah. Next slide please. Uh, Dalam proyek ini, di 2 tahun belakangan, kita bekerja sama dengan berbagai pihak, di antaranya adalah Better Work Indonesia, sebuah ALO program, dan tentu mitra kunci programs di Jakarta.
This slide shows various parties who has been collaborating with H&M, including mitra kunci.
Ya, sejak 2019.
Since 2019.
Ya, dalam dua tahun perjalanan program ini, highlight yang ingin saya sampaikan di antara highlight-highlight lain adalah workplace inclusion survey yang kita lakukan di tahun 2021.
This journey has been for 2 years. There's a lot of highlight, but among those highlight, what Bapak would like to convey is the workplace inclusion survey at 2021.
Ya, workplace inclusion survey ini adalah satu survei yang kita lakukan kepada supplier-supplier kami yang berjumlah 16 supplier. Yang survei itu diekstrak dari tiga dokumen yang sudah ada di layar ini, yaitu Employing Person with Disability dari ILO dan Panduan Kesetaraan Inklusivitas di Tempat Kerja dari Mitra Kunci.
The survey is extracting from 3 documents as seen on the right side of this page. This is from Mitra Kunci and also from USAID and also from ILO.
Ya, dan ini tadi mengkoneksikan dengan apa yang disampaikan Ibu Lensi di awal, kalau ini adalah sustainable legacy, dan kami sangat setuju dengan itu, dan kita mencoba mengimplementasikan itu melalui survei ini, karena survei ini dilakukan oleh 16 supplier kami yang melakukan survei itu dan kemudian melakukan perbaikan-perbaikan berdasarkan survei yang tadi.
This connect to the present Ibu Lensi presentation. We want to make sure that the legacy is sustained or sustainable legacy by implementation of various of the principle. And the survey is conducted to the 16 supplier.
Ya, dan hasil dari survei itu ada di slide selanjutnya.
The result as seen in the next slide. Next slide, please.
Jadi kalau dilihat di sini dari summary tadi, apa yang disampaikan Bu Lensi tentang sustainable legacy, kita coba ekstrak itu menjadi 7 bagian focus area.
The sustainable legacy contained of 7 focus area as seen on the screen.
Yeah, the sustainable legacy that I meant here is the one that Ibu Lensi shared earlier about having the guidebook as a legacy so that the program can be sustained. So itu ada 7 kriteria. Dari sini bisa dilihat kalau dari survei yang dilakukan di supplier kami, kita bisa melihat kalau ada improvement area yang bisa kita address untuk bisa menjadi lebih inklusif dari 16 supplier yang kita lakukan survei.
This slide shows the improvement area. So the among the 16 companies that from our supply chain that joined the survey, this slide shows that there are still room for improvement in terms of
jadi, legacy. Setiap perusahaan supplier yang ikut dalam program ini, ada 16 supplier tadi, itu melakukan improvement area di bidang-bidang yang mereka rasa perlu dilakukan perbaikan untuk bisa menjadi lebih inklusif, dan di sana mereka bisa menentukan prioritas apa yang harus diperbaiki lebih dulu.
The 16 participant of the survey can decide the priority which one they want to move forward with in order to have a more inclusive workplace.
Dan dengan pendekatan seperti ini, setiap individual supplier punya action plan yang berbeda-beda sesuai dengan kebutuhan mereka.
Thus, the action plan of each of the participant companies or 16 companies are different according to their needs.
Dan kami berencana untuk melakukan survei ini setiap tahun agar supaya ini bisa menjadi lebih sustainable dan continuous improvement.
to make sure that it will become a continuous improvement and sustainable, this will be conducted annually.
Slide selanjutnya, ketika kita bicara tentang capaian, apa yang sudah dicapai oleh beberapa supplier kita, mereka menyampaikan hal-hal berikut di slide berikutnya.
Next slide on the progress. Next slide. On progress.
This is the ini yang disampaikan oleh teman-teman supplier kami tentang apa yang dianggap bagi mereka sebagai capaian.
The participant of the survey, the supplier, this is what they consider as the achievement.
Dalam salah satu contoh ini disebutkan dalam salah satu pabrik yang mengikuti survei ini, mereka menyatakan kalau gambar ini menyatakan kalau satu karyawan dengan disabilitas sudah diangkat menjadi dari operator menjadi leaders atau supervisors.
This is just one of the example, the one of the our friend with disability from operator he has climbed the ladder and become the leader, one of the leader in the company.
Dan ini membuktikan kalau misalnya equal opportunity itu benar terjadi. Dan ini hanya salah satu contoh. Kita ada sekitar 10 atau 11 supplier, 11 orang dengan disabilitas yang menjadi supervisor.
This shows that equal opportunity is truly possible. And also Bapak mentioned there's already 11 people with disability who has reached supervisor.
Ini salah satu contoh dan slide selanjutnya.
Next slide, please.
Tetapi tentu semua itu dimulai dari hal-hal yang dinilai kecil, yaitu contohnya adalah membuka lowongan pekerjaan untuk mengajak teman-teman disabilitas untuk ikut apply juga.
All has to start with the first step, the small step. First to open the vacancy that invite people with disability also to apply.
Mungkin ini kedengarannya seperti sebuah langkah kecil dan mungkin dianggap ringan oleh sebagian orang, tetapi ini adalah suatu hal yang penting bagaimana kita membuka kesempatan itu di awal.
Some people may look at this as a small step, but it's an important gate to start with.
Itu sebagian contoh dari hal-hal cerita-cerita yang disampaikan oleh teman-teman supplier kami tentang pencapaian yang mereka lakukan.
So there is the stories that we heard from our supplier chain members related to the effort that they have made.
Slide selanjutnya, please. Kami ingin sharing progres kami. Yang pertama adalah survei yang dilakukan tadi di awal itu sebenarnya survei yang kedua. Tetapi sebelumnya di 2020 kita pernah melakukan, kita fokus untuk memperbaiki policy dari perusahaan supplier-supplier yang ikut dalam program ini. Dan dalam 2020 survei kita melakukan satisfactory survey yang menyatakan kalau workers itu merasa mendapatkan manfaat dari inclusive policy yang ada di perusahaan tersebut.
The presentation you've seen before is actually the second one. The company have conducted the first survey before this to improve the policy. And among the survey, it is concluded that the worker felt a more inclusive and comfortable workplace.
Dan sampai dengan 2021 sudah ada sekitar 416 pekerja dengan disabilitas di 16 supplier factories kita.
By 2021 there are 416 workers with disability in 16 factories.
Selain itu juga continuous development untuk inclusive policies and training and on workers in workplace inclusions terus dijalankan di 16 pabrik yang sudah mengikuti program ini.
As has Bapak has read number 3 continuous development.
Ya, dan selanjutnya juga progres tentang perbaikan-perbaikan physical accommodations to meet the special untuk memenuhi kebutuhan khusus dari pekerja-pekerja dengan disabilitas itu terus dilakukan.
Continue to progress on physical accommodation to meet the special needs of the worker.
Kalau teman-teman lihat dengan gambar yang ada di sebelah kanan, itu adalah salah satu contoh dari adjustment yang dilakukan dalam proses kerja mereka untuk karyawan-karyawan di bagian penjahit untuk bisa teman-teman dengan disabilitas bisa bekerja dengan nyaman, yaitu adjustment di tinggi bangku dan sedikit di peralatan kerjanya.
The picture on the right side shows the real adjustment that the company try to make, for example, to make sure that the employee are comfortable, for example, adjusting the height of the chair and also some adjusting some equipment.
Dan juga ada berbagai cerita inspiratif yang di antara teman-teman supplier ini yang sudah yang sebenarnya bisa kita sharing untuk bisa menjadikan inspirasi bagi teman-teman yang lain.
There are so many inspirative story from our friend with disability who has worked, and it can be a good inspiration for all of us.
Yeah, finally, I just want to say thank you for Mitra Kunci for the 2 years of inspirations. I mean, we have been working to find a systematic way on becoming more inclusive. How can we encourage more inclusive workplace in our supply chains? And we, you know, has been a lot of inspirations from that. We at the 2020 we come up with focusing on policy, and 2021 we are focusing more into a more technical part. So the steps are there, the inspirations are there, and I just want to say thank you for this collaborations, and it's been a lot of support from Mitra Kunci so that we can share this progress.
Very much, Suleiman. We do have two speakers left, and I know that we are only at 8 minutes left. So if anyone is able to, or any of the participants are able to stay a little bit longer, please feel free to do so. Next, we will actually be going with our fifth speaker, now fourth, Ramawati Wulan Prasetya, a person with disability sharing her personal experience. And Drew, if you could please also be sure to pin Ramawati's video along with the presentation. Thank you very much. To you, Ramawati.
Berikutnya, Ibu Rahmawati.
Rahma, bisa dengar kita, Mbak? Mbak Inul, Mbak Husnul bantu Mbak Rahma ya?
Ya, Mbak Rahma posisinya sendiri ya, kayaknya.
Sendiri? Oke. Dia harus menyalakan kameranya ya.
Mbak Ramawati sudah menyalakan kamera.
Sudah menyalakan kamera, tapi belum dipin ya.
Mr. Luke, would you please pin Miss Ramawati? She has turned on her camera.
Excellent. And Drew and Will, would you please pin Ramawati now that her camera is on? Thank you very much. Excellent, thank you. And to the last slide, thank you very much. To you, Ramamurti.
Halo, Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Selamat malam semuanya. Perkenalkan, nama saya Rahmawati.
I want to introduce myself. My name is Rahmawati.
Nama panjang saya Rahmawati Wulan.
My full name is Rahmawati Wulan Prasetya.
Saya tinggal di Pasuruan, Jawa Timur.
I live in Pasuruan, East Java.
Yeah, next slide. Saya mau cerita tentang pengalaman saya bekerja.
I would like to tell you about how I finally got to work in the company.
Dan berjuang untuk mencari pekerjaan.
And fighting how to get a job.
Di tempat tinggal saya di Pasuruan.
My place, Pasuruan.
Mencari pekerjaan di Pasuruan itu sangat sulit.
Finding a job in Pasuruan is very difficult.
Terutama untuk orang-orang disabilitas itu membutuhkan.
Especially with
perjuangan yang sangat keras.
It needs a really hard work.
Saya dulu berasal dari sekolah luar biasa, SLB. Setelah lulus dari SLB, saya mencari pekerjaan. Akan tetapi, saya gagal dalam mencari pekerjaan dan menganggur selama 2 tahun.
I studied in the special needs school, and then after graduated, I tried to find a job myself, but it didn't work. So I was finding for 2 years.
Tahun lalu saya ikut sebuah pelatihan di BLK di daerah Pandaan.
Last year I conducted training in BLK.
Dan pelatihannya berupa pelatihan menjahit.
Ini itu sewat sewing training.
Yang mana? Sebentar. Sekolah saya yang mengundang ikut pelatihan menjahit sekolah yang mana sekolah saya mengundang saya untuk ikut pelatihan menjahit di tempat yang mana bekerja sama dengan Dinas Tenaga Kerja dan Babeda Pasuruan di Batu Yusaid Mitakunji.
Later I found out that it was the result of a collaboration between the school that I studied, the Manpower Office and the Pasuruan Agency Babeda. We are all assisted by the Yusaid Mitakunji program.
Selama situasi pandemi ini banyak tempat pelatihan yang tutup dan saya sangat beruntung sekali bisa mengikuti pelatihan ini selama 18 hari.
Many training opportunities were closed, so I was so lucky that I can join this training which is conducted for 18 days.
Dan dari pelatihan tersebut saya mendapatkan banyak ilmu dan ilmu yang sangat bermanfaat untuk kami.
And from the training I got a lot of knowledge and then it's very really really beneficial for me.
Ya, di next slide. Di tempat sekolah kami ada tempat pelatihan kerja khusus. Dan
meanwhile Well, at our school there is a special job fair.
Ada 3 orang yang dari pelatihan tersebut diterima kerja di PT FMC.
There are 3 people that was from the training was accepted to the workplace and then to work in the PT FMC Agricultural.
Di PT FMC ini ada perusahaan pengepakan dan alat-alat pertanian.
And this company is actually is for the packing and then the agricultural company.
Jadi seperti penyediaan alat-alat obat, alat-alat pertanian dan obat-obat seperti pupuk untuk kebutuhan pertanian seperti itu.
It's a company engaged in the packaging of various products of agriculture production facilities like also fertilizers, things like that.
Kesempatan bekerja untuk tuli itu apa namanya, terutama untuk disabilitas tuli dan juga disabilitas yang lain itu sangat sulit.
Working opportunities for the people who has a hard of hearing actually is a very difficult.
Ya, pemerintah Indonesia menyatakan bahwasanya 1% orang bisa diterima bekerja, yang itu adalah orang disabilitas, tapi ternyata kenyataannya masih belum.
Even though the government, Indonesia's government said stated that 1% of the workforce can come from the people with disabilities, but in fact it's not really what it said.
Yang banyak disabilitas belum dapat pelatihan atau kerja. Saya bisa bekerja sebab kerjasama antara pemerintah, sekolah, BLK, Bisik Mitra Kunci yang mendukung di Pasuruan.
I can work as an example of the results of collaboration at the district level, where the government, schools, training providers or BLK, private parties and organizations or programs.
Di Pasuruan disebutnya disabilitas berdaya. Dengan sinergi dan kolaborasi atau disingkat Dikdaya Sibola.
In Pasuruan Regency, this coordination is called Disability Empowerment with Synergy and Collaboration, or abbreviated as Dikdaya with Sibola.
Next slide. Terima kasih. Salam dari Pasuruan Indonesia. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you for this opportunity. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Very much. We very much appreciate the time and the presentation, Ramwati. Now we'd like to go to our final panelists, to Ika Ningtyas, the Secretary General Alliance of Independent Journalists of Indonesia, for our final presentation. And Ika is going to be discussing building the inclusive and sustainable development through media advocacy. Over to you, Ika. Thank you.
Thank you, Luke. Hello, for everyone. I'm very happy to be invited to join this event. I'm Ika Ningtyas, currently as a General Secretary of the Alliance of Independent Journalists, or AJ. I will present how our organization evolved to strengthen the issue of inclusion in journalism. Hopefully, we can find each other good practices from tonight's event. Next slide. Hi, Mbak Hilda. Do you want to...
Boleh lanjut lanjut dulu ke slide yang pertama, silakan.
Translation.
Dilanjut ke slide pertama, lanjut Bu. Bapak Ibu, kita akan mendengarkan presentasi dari Ibu Ika. Topiknya adalah memperkuat isu inklusi di media. Silakan Ibu Ika.
I will introduce my organization first. I one of the organization, 1,800 member. And 40 branches in various provinces in Indonesia. Our organization has three main vision, namely our fighting for press freedom, increasing professionalism, and improving the welfare of journalists.
Bapak Ibu, organisasi Aliansi Jurnalis Independen ini sudah berdiri sejak tahun 1994. Anggotanya ada 1.800, mohon saya dikoreksi Bu kalau salah, di 40 cabang. Kemudian juga yang diperjuangkan adalah kebebasan pers, kesejahteraan para jurnalis, dan juga profesionalisme.
Next slide. As part of our commitment to defending vulnerable group, we have a special division, namely the division of gender, children, and marginalized groups. This division works to ensure that organizations and also externally fight for the principle of the marginalized group, including people with disabilities.
Bapak, mohon maaf tadi saya mendengarnya terputus-putus, tapi yang saya dengar adalah ada divisi khusus untuk memperjuangkan isu-isu inklusivitas ini, termasuk terkait kesetaraan gender, kemudian mempromosikan hak anak, juga equality untuk semua masyarakat, teman-teman LGBT, juga teman-teman dengan disabilitas.
In next slide, yeah, of course the media plays an important role to realize work including involved journalism. Yeah, next slide, please. Media organization everywhere must ensure that there are equality, no rule that discriminate against gender or minority group, allow everyone to have fair access and have a reporting mechanism where discrimination occurred. The role of the media must also ensure that the news that matters is more voicing for group who voice of voiceless, vulnerable groups such as group with disabilities and voices anti-discrimination in society. The media must educate the public why inclusion is important for the well-being of all of us.
Jadi organisasi media, ya, organisasi media berusaha memastikan ada kesetaraan, tidak ada diskriminasi, ada akses yang fair atau adil, juga ada sistem pelaporan kalau orang mengalami ketidakadilan tersebut. Kemudian juga ingin memastikan bahwa suara teman-teman yang rentan bisa disampaikan, menyampaikan suara-suara dari orang-orang yang belum terdengar suaranya atau the voiceless, dan juga mengedukasi terkait pentingnya inklusivitas.
The third, the media must also monitor the existing discrepancies implementation. This is actually reduced right that for vulnerable group have to accept it. Next slide. Next slide, please. One of the things that IG has been successfully reporting, this guideline published by our press council in Indonesia. IG was intensely involved in the guide now, so the media have some kind of guidance on what to do and to it when journalists write about disabilities issues. For 5 months, we work with USAID as partner on a media inclusive one of video series, disability reporting guideline. We distribute this video more widely on YouTube, Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. In this way, we hope that more journalists in Indonesia will know better about the content of this guideline.
Bapak Ibu, jadi ini adalah pencapaian luar biasa yang dicapai adalah salah satunya membuat sebuah guideline reporting. Di sini konteksnya adalah bagaimana membuat pemberitaan terkait isu-isu atau berita tentang teman-teman disabilitas. Kemudian juga dari AJI memastikan ini bisa disebarluaskan ke lebih luas ke kalangan jurnalis untuk memastikan ada guideline ini sudah diketahui oleh banyak pihak. Kemudian juga Ibu menyampaikan bahwa ini dengan dikolaborasi dengan USAID.
Oke, okay. Next slide. Okay, next slide. I realized that reporting a previous slide, I think. I realized that the reporting on issue of inclusiveness in the workplace is not major issue in the media. Some media report do not focus to cover how the access of persons with disabilities to the workplace, how various policies are implemented, and what are the challenges and obstacles to realizing an inclusive of workplace. Together with USAID Mitra Kunci, we designed workshop in a 7 regional cluster in East Java. We trained 75 journalists to implementation the reporting guideline in the journalism. And after the workshop, we provide a fellowship for 15 journalists to cover more deeply on inclusion issues in the world of work, and also in how the implementation regulation in some areas in East Java. As a result, there are 15 journalistic work that have success in revealing how to implement an inclusive workspace policies. From the news, it is known that there are many obstacles and challenges that must be faced by disabilities group to enter the workspace, but there are also many efforts that local government have begun to make the support and inclusive in our workspace, including many initiatives carried out by communities, organizations, private parties to empower disability groups. Silakan, Mbak.
Jadi disadari oleh teman-teman jurnalis bahwa yang dihadapi oleh teman-teman disabilitas ini belum menjadi isu mainstream di media kita. Maka dari itu berita ini diusahakan untuk semakin diangkat tentang hal terkait kebijakan, tantangan yang dihadapi untuk mewujudkan inklusivitas. Nah, bersama dengan USAID Mitra Kunci dibuat sebuah sudah dilakukan workshop untuk terkait reporting guideline tadi. Kemudian juga ada fellowship dengan 15 jurnalis kalau saya tidak salah dengar tadi. Kemudian yang dilakukan oleh 15 jurnalis ini adalah mengcover berita ini lebih dalam lagi, dan memang hasilnya terbukti bahwa betul banyak tantangan yang masih dihadapi oleh teman-teman dengan disabilitas di dunia kerja, tapi juga ada harapan di sana. Sudah ada usaha-usaha yang dilakukan baik oleh pemerintah, komunitas, dan sektor swasta untuk mewujudkan lingkungan kerja yang lebih inklusif ini.
Okay, for my last presentation. Okay, these various collaborative effort, of course, do not stop at the program. I need to increase knowledge of journalists regarding inclusion issues in the workspace. This effort, I think, certainly require wider collaboration with other civil society, government, local government, and including disability groups. Thank you, everyone. Hopefully, my presentation is useful for you. Thank you, Luke. I get back to you.
Thank you so much, Ika, and to all of our panelists and presenters today. It is very important for us to witness some of the impact that each of you and this program has had. Unfortunately, we are over time just a bit, so we do not have time today for the question and answer. But what I'd like to draw everyone's attention to in the chat of this WebEx presentation is the link to the landing page for this particular presentation and program. And so if any participants also have questions, we can also share in this chat box Matthew Brennan of Making Sense email, as well as Wahono Kolopaking of USAID's email. I'll post these in the chat now, and again, including a link to the landing page. And on that landing page, everyone will have access to Mitra Kunci's final report, as well as a video on the employment and economic empowerment of persons with disabilities. Nothing else with that. I don't know if Lindsay, if you have any final remarks. If not, thank you everybody. And I'll post those in the chat now.
Bapak Ibu, jadi sebelum Ibu Lensi, jadi terima kasih atas perhatiannya sejauh ini, dan terima kasih sudah menjadi saksi atas begitu banyak dampak dari program ini, dampak yang positif dari program ini. Mohon maaf, tidak waktunya sudah habis untuk Q&A, tetapi di dalam chat room Bapak Ibu bisa menemukan ada materi-materi yang akan dipost oleh Luke. Nanti ada materi-materi untuk acara kita hari ini, kemudian ada video, ada reporting dari Mitra Kunci, kemudian juga ada bisa dituliskan pertanyaan di chat box juga, kemudian juga bisa dituliskan diteruskan kalau ada pertanyaan email ke Bapak Wahono. Silakan Ibu Lensi, yep. Selanjutnya.
Ya, yeah. Hi Luke, thank you, and also thank you for everyone who join our session tonight. I saw from the list of the participant, we have Pak Dr. Himawan S. Tubagijo from East Java. This is the head of the manpower office of the East Java province. Thank you, Pak Him, for being joined with us. And also, I saw Jalu Cahyanto. This is alternate COR from USAID. Represent USAID, because Ibu Esther Manurung, our COR, is on leave now. Thank you also, Mas Jalu. Dan terima kasih untuk Bapak Ibu yang sudah menjadi pembicara hari ini. Pak Koko, terima kasih Pak Koko, Mbak Rahma, dan juga Mbak Sri.
Sama-sama, Ibu.
Matur suwun ya, Pak.
Oke.
Thank you very much for everyone who working hard to prepare this event. Mas Wahono, my colleagues will give the information, maybe the link to our social media, so you may find more information for Mitra Kunci program. Thank you.
Thank you, Lindsay. And what? You. And one last, thank you so much, Lindsay. And one last thing we would like is Bantu from Making Sense also has a few words to say. Over to you, Bantu.
Thank you so much, Luke, for moderating today's session on behalf of DAA, and to our dynamic and special speakers, we'd like to say thank you for taking the time to speak about empowerment of people with disability and the role of organizations with persons with disability. I think such topics are not discussed in many spaces, so thank you, DIA, for hosting this session. I would like to invite everyone to join us for our upcoming YO 2030 solution sessions on topic ranging from jobs to financing innovation, how young women are driving inclusion for digital work. I would be posting in the chat here our link to our event page so that you guys would have an opportunity and access to go on our website and to look at our other sessions. And once again, thank you to everybody for today's session. Back to you, Luke.
Thank you very much. Yes, and I have no other further remarks. I just like to again thank all of our panelists and everyone who's supported the presentation and the session today, to Making Sense, to USAID, and of course to the Mitra Kuchi Project and all of our panelists. Thanks everybody, and have a great day.